do you feel when you think about endings? Relief? Loss? Despair? Pain? How do we face an ending we do not choose? We're supposed to hold on to things that matter, right? But what if the end wasn't quite the end? What if there was more? John 12:24, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. What if there was a new beginning, new birth in place of your ending? Just like when he cried out, "It is finished," and grace poured down that day and his blood was shed. It was not simply just an end, but the beginning of a new life for all who would believe. So, in your place of endings, would you trust the one who has seen it all, even the pain, and know there is beauty yet to be revealed? You just haven't seen it yet.
Thank you.
What do you feel when you think about endings? Relief? Loss? Despair? Pain? How do we face an ending we do not choose? We're supposed to hold on to things that matter, right? But what if the end wasn't quite the end? What if there was more? John 12:24, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. What if there was a new beginning being birthed in place of your ending? Just like when he cried out, "It is finished," and grace poured down that day and his blood was shed, it was not simply just an end, but the beginning of a new life for all who would believe. So, in your place of endings, would you trust the one who has seen it all, even the pain, and know there is beauty yet to be revealed? You just haven't seen it yet.
Good morning, church. Can I encourage us to let's come together to seek God together and just welcome His presence in this place. And this morning, I would like to read to you from Psalms 135. Praise the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise Him, all you servants of the Lord, who stand in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God. Praise the Lord, for the Lord is good. Sing praises to His name, for it is pleasant. For the Lord has chosen Jacob for Himself, Israel for His special treasure. For I know that the Lord is great, and our Lord is above all gods. Whatever the Lord pleases, He does, in heaven and in earth, in the seas and all deep places. This morning the word is that let God do whatever He pleases in our service, in our life. We want to submit that God is sovereign and all-powerful. And so can I encourage us, those who are here and tuning in online, shall we stand? I want to pray in the Spirit and really welcome the presence of God and really give Him the room. God, do whatever You please in our service, in our life. We submit to You. We come to You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we lift up our voice for a while before I ask the worship team to lead us in this song? Kurama shara bara 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 You are sovereign over this place, O God. You are sovereign in this place. Yarabayandarabase. Sharabarabababababababababasoroboriandarabase. We give room to You. We make room to You, O God. In our hearts, in our life, in our service this morning, we make room, O God. Yarabasharabase. Yarabarabarabaso. We welcome You, Holy Spirit. We welcome You in this place. For we are Your special treasure. We are Your special treasure. Lord, do whatever You please in our service this morning. And we make room and we make way. And we invite You here. Kiaraba shara bara ba 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 se. Hiarama shara da 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 ba so. Hiarama shara da 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 ba se. Re 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 be yanda da la ba so. We need You, Lord. We need You. We need You in our life. We need You in our situation, O God. For we are Your special treasure, God. For we have a purpose. A God-given purpose and destiny. Oh, we lift up our hands and just welcome You. Welcome You. Fill us. Fill us this morning. Sing praises to his name, for it is pleasant. For the Lord has chosen you for himself, for his special treasure. For I know that the Lord is great, and our Lord is above all gods. Whatever the Lord pleases, he does, in heaven and in earth, in the seas and in all deep places. This morning our cry is that God, come and take your place, for we are chosen by you for your special treasure. We are your special treasure this morning. And with that, Lord, we come to you. Do whatever it pleases you. Do whatever that glorifies you. we lift up our lives, we lift up our situation, we lift up everything and submit it to you and say, God, we welcome you. We make way, we make room. Take hold, come into our life. May there be a great breakthrough this morning in our service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we give a big clap offering? Thank you.
Amen. Good morning, church. Maybe before we start our worship, can I just ask you to greet each other good morning? Just the people next to you. Say, I love you. God loves you. Welcome to service. It's nice to see you. Okay, let's put our hands together. Let's give our praise to our Lord. All the worship that He deserves.
From the highest throne to the earth below, you lay down your life for the likes of us. Great is the love of the Savior.
From a wounded heart,
from a wounded heart to a life made whole.
Lord of Bands, God, you reign and you rule for our hearts, God. This morning, Lord, we truly want to look to you, God, just thanking you, Lord, for your goodness in our lives. Thanking you, Lord, for who you are, Lord Jesus. And we pray, God, that indeed we'll find rest in your love wherever we are at in our lives, Lord. That your peace, God, that truly surpasses all of our own understanding will supernaturally, Lord, fill each and every heart today, Lord, as we worship you, as we look to you this morning, Lord.
You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You when my fear is crippling, you are true, you are true.
To
continue to cry out to Him for our hearts, desiring for Him, exalting His name, exalting Him.
How great is your love for us?
time there's never been.
There's never been, there'll never be a God like you, a love so true. There's never been, there'll never be a God like you, a love so true.
Sing how great.
How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great is your love. How great, how great, how great is your love for us.
One more time we sing, how great is your love.
Oh Jesus, how great, how great.
Truly thank you, Lord, for your love for us, God. Indeed, Lord, your love is great, even greater than what we can even ourselves imagine or wonder, Lord God. God, I pray, God, that this morning, Lord, we'll truly find rest in your love for us, Lord God. We truly find rest in your love, Lord. That in you, Lord, we know there's no condemnation. In you, Lord, we know there's no guilt, Lord God. That we can come before you as who we are, Lord, as your children, needing your grace, needing your love. So God, this morning we surrender our hearts, we surrender our lives, Lord. Just come, Lord.
So with you above.
Jesus. What an awesome God we have. What a great God we serve. I'm reading from Acts chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 2. And a man who had been lame from his mother's womb was being carried along, whom they used to set down every day at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, in order to beg alms of those who were entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he began asking to receive alms. Church, some of us could be in a desperate situation right now, desperate seeking for a breakthrough, desperate seeking for a touch of the Holy Spirit. Let me assure you, the Holy Spirit is here and He's saturating this place. And sometimes we may just be looking for a temporary touch, but the Lord wants to give you more. Sometimes we settle for mediocrity and we think that is perfection, but the Lord wants to give us more. Let's remember God's faithfulness throughout the years that we have been with Him. Let's remember the time that He healed an impossible sickness in the family. Let's remember the time when there was an impossible situation that only the Holy Spirit can do, and He did it. Let's remember the time that He brought salvation to the most difficult family member of the house. Our God is a God of impossible, amen. I say it again, our God is a God of impossible, amen. We serve a great and mighty God, amen. We serve a great and a majestic God, amen. That today, let's stand before Him. And even when the oceans rise in our lives, church, I don't know what your oceans are. I have my own oceans that I'm battling. But when the oceans rise, when the thunders roar, I'm going to soar with Him. Because I know He is my God. Let's sing that. When the oceans rise and thunders roar. Hallelujah.
When the oceans rise and thunders roar.
To the Lord today.
I will soar with you above the storm.
Oh Father, you are King.
Father, you are King over the flood.
I'll be still.
I will be still, though you are God.
The oceans.
When the oceans rise,
hallelujah.
And thunders roar.
Hallelujah.
I will soar.
I will soar with you. Oh yes, Lord, above the storm.
Father, you are King over the flood.
Oh, I will be still.
I will be still. Know you were my God.
I will be still.
I will be still. Know you are my God. I will be still. Know you.
Church, I think we can do better. Let's raise up a shout unto the Lord God Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Hallelujah. Thank you. The same attitude of prayer. Can I ask you all to take your seats? You want to prepare for the congregational prayer? Can I have the slides up? Hallelujah. Scripture today is taken from Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Let's pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the transforming power of the Holy Spirit indwelling within us that helps us to bear His fruit and turn away from the works of the flesh continually. Cause us to walk closely with the Holy Spirit to know Him more and to keep in step with His ways every day. Teach us through His constant presence to look at ourselves with sober judgment, seeing all that is revealed and concealed within us from your perspective. Grant us the strength and grace that we will need to persevere in living in obedience to your commandments in this world. May we draw others around us to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, even as our lives are being transformed by the Holy Spirit. May we ultimately live lives that will cause others to give glory to you. And this we pray in Jesus' name. And FGA says, FGA says, amen. 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 Now I want to pray for all of us who have a need in this house. As I said, church, do you believe that God is in this house? Only 10 people believe. I ask again, do you believe that God is in this house? Yes. If you believe that God is in His house, and if you believe that you serve a great and a mighty God, and if you believe that we serve a God that provides breakthrough, then it is time to trust Him with our issues. So if you have a need in this house, it can be your own need. It can be a need for your family. You're standing in proxy for someone that you love. I'd like to ask you to stand. You're standing not for me, not to the elders, not to the pastors, but you're standing to God. Remember, the scripture says, Peter and John says, look at us. Look at God today. God is in this house. All eyes closed. If you're around and you see someone standing next to you, won't you reach out your hand to them? We are family. We are family, church. Let's reach out to them. Because they are standing with a need. They're standing because there is an impossible situation. They're standing because they need healing in the house, a financial breakthrough. Or they could be standing for their loved ones in need of salvation. Desperate situation. The God is a God of impossibility. We serve a great and a mighty God. Kevaka Sandaraba. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for we serve a great and mighty God. And how great is your love for us, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. We praise you. Thank you, Lord, for all those people who are standing. So many of us that are standing in this house. Father, you know their needs. And they could be like that man in Acts chapter 3 who are desperate for alms. But Lord, you want to give more. You want to pour your Spirit unto them. Holy Spirit, take charge of each and everyone that is standing in this place. Holy Spirit, we pray for an outpouring of the Holy Spirit like never before. Lord, we pray. Lord, I say, as Peter and John say, silver and gold have I none, but I give you in the name of Jesus, be healed in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough in the name of Jesus. Be set free in the name of Jesus. There's liberation in this house and those who are online in your homes. Be set free in the name of Jesus. For we serve a great and mighty God. Lord, touch them powerfully. Lord, minister unto them powerfully. Some of them are standing for their children. Some of them are standing for their parents. Some of them, Lord, are in such desperate situation. Some of them are on the verge of giving up. Lord, we pray for a breakthrough in the name of Jesus. For we serve a great and mighty God. Lord, how great is your love for us. Lord, we thank you for the testimonies that's coming. We thank you for the breakthrough that is coming. Lord, we thank you for the healing that is coming. We thank you for the economic providence that you are our Jehovah Jireh. You are God, our provider. We thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we lift every one of them up in the name of Jesus. Amen. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we ask and we pray. And the church says, amen, amen. Let's sing this last song as you all sit down. Let's sing this last song. How great is your love for us? Just the chorus. Unto our God. How great is your love for us. How great is your love for us. Let's pray for the offering. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are our God, our provider. You are our Jehovah Jireh. And we thank you that everything that we have comes from you and from you alone. So help us, Lord, to give cheerfully, wonderfully, for the furtherance of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we ask and we pray. Amen and amen. The slide is up for all the different methods that you can contribute to your offering. Please take note. Thank you, worship team. Can we give them a clap offering? Right. Welcome to Full Gospel Assembly. Okay, I'm speaking to myself. I'll try to say it again. Okay, there are 10 people are excited. Welcome home to Full Gospel Assembly. I want to welcome you in the physical service and also those who are online. Thank you for joining us. May God bless all of you. So I would like to invite those who are here for the first time. Can you please stand? We want to welcome you, FGA style. Is there anyone there? There's one sister over there. Can those around them please shake their hands? Remain standing, yeah? Please remain standing. There's somehow other people here in this house. Please remain standing. There will be someone coming to you to give you an invitation card. So until you receive your invitation card, do not sit down. So if you're joining us for the first time in our physical service, online people, physical service on here, please come and join us next week online, okay? Physical, okay? Then you'll get an invitation card. There is a QR code on the card and also on the screen for those who are joining us for first time. Do scan it and leave us a bit of information so that we can connect with you better. Also, for those who are joining us in person, remember to collect your special welcome bag downstairs. Online people, special welcome bag. Please come and join us next week at the hospitality lounge. See you downstairs. Right, now, the next in line, we have some special announcements before I pass the time to a special doctor who is going to do baby dedication today. So there are some important announcements. Please take note. First and foremost, there's an announcement from the mission side. We need help for the FGA flood relief works. The flood waters have started to recede in Batu Pahat, and the FGA relief team will be moving to work with CREST, his team 7979, and ACRA to assist in helping the flood victims to clear and clean their houses, especially in the areas of Sri Gading, Sri Medan, and Pavit Raja. This will happen coming Saturday, 25th of March, and Sunday, 26th of March. So we are looking for more volunteers to form at least 3 teams of 8 people. So that means we are looking for minimum 24 people for the cleaning process. Those who would like to respond, please go to the basement lobby after the service today. And there is a booth where you can get more information. Training on safety and hydro cleaner operation will be also held today at 3 p.m. So please join us. Those who are moved to join this flood relief work, please take note, go downstairs at the basement today to look for the booth. Thank you. Now, the second thing is parking at Plaza Prima. Okay, so this is to inform everyone that free parking, woohoo, has been arranged for vehicles entering Plaza Prima between 7 a.m. to 3 p.m. Okay, not p.m., no one is excited. Okay. On Sundays, vehicles entering within these times will not be charged for exit. So 7 a.m. to 3 p.m., vehicles entering these times will not be charged for exit. However, brothers and sisters, please take note. You still need to use your touch and go card to titit lah. You need to tag in and tag out of the parking, and the touch and go card must have a minimum $10 lah. Don't lah, without less than $10, out there you scold the guard. Don't scold the guard lah. Okay, minimum 10 ringgit in the touch and go card. Okay, so we have a special function today, baby dedication. So I want to pass the time to a special doctor. Dr. Pauline, can you come and take charge and do the baby dedication? Thank you.
Good morning, church. To you, blessed morning to all of you here, as well as those online. Today is baby's dedication day. So first up, we want to show you a video of what we do in Cradle Row with all these babies, and I hope you treat it as an invitation. Video. There's some of the things we do there, and I'm one of the teachers. I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Pauline, and I'm one of the Cradle Row teachers. So I'm sure when you're watching the video, you're all wondering why start so early, right? And from the Bible, we know that King Josiah was hardly 8 years old when he had to become king of Judah. David had to face Goliath when he was hardly a teenager. And now what about Daniel and his brave three friends? They were barely 9 or 10 years old when they were on exile and have to stand up for Christ. Yeah? And if y'all don't sound very convinced by the Old Testament encouragements, so let me try a New Testament one. Even Jesus himself said, "Let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for such is the kingdom of heaven." And that is found in 3 out of the 4 Gospels. So how important is that? So we hope you start early. Start introducing your children, grandchildren to Jesus very, very early. And this is mainly done at home, we know. Yeah? But every Sunday, you can bring them for booster lessons at our Sunday school. We have Sunday school lessons from 0 to 12 years old. Yeah? And if you have, say you don't have grandchildren anymore or children, you can bring your friends' children. Invite them. And then we'll fulfill our M100. Yeah? Yeah. So, and we all know the ripple effect. One little life brought for Christ, he or she will be a witness to the family, to the schools where they will be, and later when they grow up in their workplace, and to the ends of the earth. So let's start early, okay? Thank you. And this morning, we have a group of parents who wants to do exactly that. And we have at least, we have 12 babies to be dedicated. These parents want to say that they want to bring their children up in the way of the Lord, in God's holy presence here in the sanctuary, and with all of you as their witnesses. So you can say a prayer for them and can encourage them when you see the little children in the corridors, in the basement. Yeah, as I read the names, will the parents make your way out to the front? Yeah. Okay. This morning we have Anya Ui, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Ui, Woon Yu. Andrew Lim, son of Mr. and Mrs. Timothy Lim. Annalise Majel Lingesh, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Gabriel Lingesh. We have Benjamin Isaac Howe, son of Mr. and Mrs. Kenny Howe. Caleb Yee, son of Mr. and Mrs. Joshua Yee. Daniel Yao, son of Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Yao King Shen. Emery Grace Daniel, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Daniel Josiah D. Cruz. Haley Kate Matthew, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Philip Ryan Matthew. Jacob Ethan Chu, son of Mr. and Mrs. Susanto Chu. Joseph Wang, son of Mr. and Mrs. Andrew Wang. Ryan Chu, son of Mr. and Mrs. Chu Beng Han. And Samuel Sun, son of Mr. and Mrs. Alvin Sun Kui Sam. And behind them are all their parents and grandparents also. Yeah? Now I'd like to invite Brother David, who's a core leader in our children ministry, to do the dedication. Thank you.
Church. Yeah, my name is David Leung. Okay, before we start, okay, we just want to thank God for this wonderful event right now, and praise God for all the wonderful children and the parents as well. Okay, I shall lead the parents onto the baby dedication prayer, service prayer. Okay, maybe right now the parents, can you face me? Okay. Okay, now we have the slides above. Okay, what happened is I'm going to lead you into the prayer, into the dedication. And I want, after I finish every sentence, I want you guys to say a resounding yes, or we do, or we will. Okay? Can do that? Okay, let's do this. Okay. Okay. Do you know what it means to present your child before God in solemn dedication? Amen. Will you then consecrate yourselves as parents to bring up your child in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Okay, thank you. Amen. Will you promise to instruct your child in the teachings of Jesus Christ and in the practice of prayer, and to guide your child in the development of a Christ-like character? Amen. Will you promise to try to the best of your ability to shape the home child of your child, home life of your child, both by family devotions and by your words and your example, that your child will, at the proper age, most naturally come to an open confession of Christ and into the fellowship and the service of the church? Amen. Now I'll say the charge to the parents. Inasmuch as you have promised before God and these people to dedicate your child to God and yourselves to the task of rearing him or her for God, I charge you to address yourselves faithfully to this sacred obligation with wisdom, patience, and devotion. And to this end, may the blessing of God rest upon you. Okay, now we would like the parents to say this prayer of dedication together. Okay, 1, 2, go. Lord, we thank you for this child that you have given us. We give him or her back to you to worship and serve you. And whatever you want him or her to be, we will be happy to guide him or her accordingly. Give us wisdom to teach him or her your ways and to put you first in her or life. We look to you for grace to enable us to keep this treasure with to be given back to you. Teach us to love this child with a holy love and to inspire him or her to know you, love you, and serve you. Help us to speak to him or her about you and your love so that his or her heart may be easily be won, early be won for you. May our whole lives be an inspiration to this child to help him or her to see what is pure, lovely, and pleasing to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, and in closing, yes, we are done. Okay, and in closing, we would like to invite Chairman Elderly to come up for a prayer blessing for the babies and of course for the parents as well. Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Parents and children, you turn the face of congregation, please. Can I invite all of you all to stand, all right? Stretch forth thy hand to bless the babies, children, the parents. Father God, our Father in heaven, thank you and praise you, God, for thy blessing, Father, of this gift of life to each of these parents, each of these children, Father. Lord, we thank you that, God, you have blessed them with this gift, and now, Lord, they have, Lord, surrendered them back to you to be raised, Father, in the way of the Lord, Father, in the way, Father, that these children will grow up, Father, Lord, to be sought and liked and witnesses for your kingdom. As parents, Father, Lord, Bless them with the fear of God, that they will raise the children, Father, with love and compassion, Father, that God truly, Father, is challenging to raise these children, Father, but Lord, you are there with them, Father. Lord, thy presence and thy Holy Spirit are with them, Father, as parents, and that God, you, O Lord, we give them the strength, the wisdom, and the understanding to overcome all circumstances in raising these children. And Lord, bless these children, Father, to be in good health and in strength, Father. Lord, the parents shall raise these children in the way of the Lord, that God, they will grow up, Father, to seek your kingdom and your righteousness, Father. Trusting you, O God, with all their hearts in your way, Father. And that God, bless these children to give thanks to you for their parents as they are raised, Father, Lord, for your glory, Father. We thank you that God, you reminded us, as the psalmist says, Father, children are a reward and sons a heritage. Right? Arrows in the hands of a warrior. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. Lord, continue to bless his parents, Father, as they raise their children, Father, in your way, Father, to be, Father, children of light, Father, and that God, they, O Lord, will know thy word, Father. Let thy word, Father, be a light unto their path, and God, a lamp unto their feet, Father. Thank you that God, truly, Father, each of these children, Father, will be in good health and in strength, covered and protected by thy mighty hand, Father. As they are raised, Father, God, you are with them too, Father. It's never too young, Father, for a child, Father, to know you, Father. For God, thy Holy Spirit shall be upon them, Father. Let these children, Father, grow up to praise you and give you thanks, Father. And God, let thy word, Father, Lord, be ministered to them through the parents, Father. God, we thank you and we praise you once again, Father, that these children have been dedicated unto you and the parents, Father, have chose to abide in you, Father. So, Lord, we thank you and we praise you. All this we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Thank you. Before I step down, I just want to thank each and every one of you for praying for me, and you have noticed this morning, my voice has been restored by the grace of God. Thank you for all your prayers. Those are here in the sanctuary. Those are online. Last Thursday, I went to my ENT, and the doctor has confirmed that my voice has been restored. So thank you, all of you. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you, Chairman Adelie. Okay, thank you so much. We are done. Okay, the parents and children, you may go back to your seats. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Children's Ministry. Can we give them another clap offering? Quite frankly, I am thankful for FGA's Children's Ministry. All three of my children were blessed by all the teachers. So I would like to just take a 30-minute promo 30-second promo, not minutes. Brother Marcus, sorry. No tension. 30-second promo to just tell you guys how my children, all three of my girls, were blessed by the children ministry teachers. Until today, they still remember the acts of kindness, the sacrifice, and the efforts that all the teachers, which is mainly consists of all of you, has done for them. So thank you for your efforts. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your service, children ministry teachers. I know they are all serving in their classrooms, but I hope they hear this. Thank you. God bless the children's ministry. Now, without much delay, we have a very super anointed preacher today. No pressure, Brother Marcus. Brother Marcus Yong is our speaker today, and he has attended FGA since 1985. Marcus is currently the head of department, the HOD of the Home Fellowship Department. And he's also the zone leader for Zone 4. He also serves as a trainer in personal evangelism SET classes. Now, Brother Marcus is married to a very beautiful Sister Valerie. Can I ask her to stand? She's going to scold me after this. Clap la properly. Ah, she's so shy, no? Can I sit in front there? Ah, okay. And they are blessed to have two wonderful children, Megan and Method. So, church, put your hands together, FGA style, and welcome Brother Marcus Yong.
Thanks, Brother Joe. Good morning, church. Isn't it wonderful to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Praise the Lord. This morning, we are going to continue on our series on Holy Spirit-empowered discipleship. In the last 2 weeks, Brother Waimi and Brother Paul have given us some excellent sharing on the power of the Holy Spirit and living by the Holy Spirit. And today we're going to be looking at the empowering works of the Holy Spirit. So before we begin, let us pray. Hallelujah. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for this opportunity to gather here in your presence. And even as we come here this morning, Father, we pray that you open our ears and our hearts so that we may hear your voice this morning. Father, I pray that you will use me this morning to share your words. Fill me with your grace and your power of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I pray that you will move in this place this morning, empower each and every one of us this morning. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. This morning, I will be speaking from the text taken from Acts chapter 3, verse 10, the very same verse that Brother Joe shared this morning, and it's entitled, Silver and Gold I Have None. And as I was preparing for this message, and while I was making some notes on the key points, I realized that a lot of the key points have already been said and have already been shared, you know, by our Elder Saw, Elder Ho, Elder Dorai, as well as, Vernon Falls in the last 2 months. There are and there will be a lot of repetition in the sermons on the Holy Spirit. And these repetitions are not because of poor planning on our part, but it is a sign of the importance of the key concepts and Bible verses on the Holy Spirit. So before we look into Acts 3 this morning, it is important that we have a quick recap. Yeah? We want to look at the important key aspects, the important key concepts on the Holy Spirit. I want to lay out the context for understanding the text that we are going to be looking at today. And this will establish the basic understanding and so that we can be on the same page as we go through Acts 3. Okay, let's start with Acts 1 and 2. And I would like to summarize three key points. The first one is gift of the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, verse 38, the Bible reads, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." When we talk about the gift of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, it shouldn't be mistaken for gifts from the Holy Spirit. Yeah? The gifts from the Holy Spirit are spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit bestows on us. This gift of the Holy Spirit that we are talking about is the Holy Spirit Himself. It's the promise of the Holy Spirit that was promised to us in John chapter 14, verse 16 and 17. Elder Saw had already spoken about the promise of the gift of the Holy Spirit from God. So we won't go through it again, but I want to mention some of the other terms that we use for gift of the Holy Spirit. And that is baptism with the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit, or receiving the Holy Spirit. Now, when we look at Acts chapter 2, verse 38, there is a twofold work of God here. And the first part, it says, when a person repents and believes in Jesus and accepts Jesus as his and Lord, as his and her Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit baptizes the person in the name of Jesus. Now, this mustn't be mistaken for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. This is the baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. This is what happens when a person receives eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. However, it's still the work of the Holy Spirit here. It's the forgiveness of sin, rebirth of the person in spirit, and the spiritual unity of that person with God through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. What happens here is the Holy Spirit baptizes or immerses the new believer into the life of Jesus. And that's the first part. Then comes the second part. Jesus then gives and fills the believer with the Holy Spirit. Do you follow? Right? There's two parts here, right? The Holy Spirit first puts the believer into the life of Jesus Christ. And then Jesus puts the Holy Spirit into the believer. And this is a promise for everyone. Acts chapter 2, 39, it says, for the promise is for you, for your children, and for all. And that means all of us. All of us who have been called by the Lord will be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen? Next, we are empowered by the Holy Spirit when we are filled by the Holy Spirit, filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. I must again make a very clear distinction of receiving power, being empowered by the Holy Spirit. Okay, there's a difference between empowered by the Holy Spirit and receiving spiritual gifts from the Holy Spirit. The difference is that not everyone who is filled with the Holy Spirit will receive or operate in the spiritual gifts from the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 11, the Bible says, it is the Holy Spirit who determines which gifts each person shall have. But everyone who is filled with the Holy Spirit will receive the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Bible records Jesus telling his disciples twice, that they would receive power once the Holy Spirit comes upon them. And the first time is in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, which we just read, and that's also in Luke 24, verse 49. And he reads, and I will send the Holy Spirit just as my Father promised, but stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from heaven. These two verses actually verify the twofold work of God, because the disciples were already baptized in the name of Jesus when Jesus told them that the Holy Spirit will come and fill them. And notice that when Jesus said that, he said the Holy Spirit will come and the Holy Spirit will fill them with power. So being filled with the Holy Spirit and receiving the power of the Holy Spirit happens at the same time. In fact, when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, you are empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that means all of us, right, who are believers, who are authentic disciples of Jesus Christ, we are filled and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit through Jesus. And if you are not, you will be. Amen? Okay, then, next, as believers, once we have been empowered by the Holy Spirit, okay, once we are filled by the Holy Spirit, we'll be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And the word empower means to give power, to authorize, to give ability, or to enable someone to do something that they otherwise cannot do on their own. So, what is it that the Holy Spirit empowers us or gives us power or authorizes us or enables us to do? In Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth." And Jesus says that when you are empowered by the Holy Spirit, you will have a supernatural power, a supernatural ability to be a witness for Him. Amen? In John chapter 15, verse 26, Jesus said, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, He will testify about Me." Here it says that the Holy Spirit, which Jesus sends to us from God, is to testify about Jesus. The word testify means to give evidence as a witness. So the Holy Spirit, who is in us, gives us the very same power, the very same ability to testify and to be a witness for Jesus. In other words, the purpose of the baptism with the Holy Spirit was to empower all of us to reveal Jesus Christ throughout the earth. Now, the Holy Spirit just doesn't empower us to tell about what Jesus did, but also empowers us to do what Jesus did. In John chapter 14, verse 12, Jesus said, "Whoever believes in Me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater than this." And verse 16, Jesus said, "I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever." So the Holy Spirit helps us to do what Jesus did. You follow? Jesus said that as authentic disciples, we will continue His work, and we will do this with the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of the Holy Spirit will enable us to do what Jesus did. Now, up to this point, I have been very careful to make a clear distinction between the power of the Holy Spirit and the spiritual gifts from the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, verse 4, it reads, "All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and begin to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them." When disciples are filled with the Holy Spirit, they are given a special ability. They are given a special gift, or given many special, spiritual gifts. In this case, the disciples who were in the upper room, they were given the gift of speaking in tongues. When we are empowered by the Holy Spirit in us is evidenced or manifested by spiritual gifts from the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, it says, "Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good." The passage actually says that to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit. So each and every one of us, each and every one, every Christian, each and every disciple of Jesus can manifest the Holy Spirit because each and every one of us has the Holy Spirit in them. In Acts chapter 1, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he actually goes on to mention 9 different spiritual gifts. Now, I won't go through that today, but it says that it is given for the common good. In other words, it is given for us to help each other. There's a pre-service prayer that takes place here in the basement every Sunday before our Sunday service. For about a year now, we have gathered in the basement to pray before our Sunday service. What started out as a handful of our members coming together to pray for our Sunday service had become a packed basement of our members coming to just soak in the presence of God with a thirst and hunger for the Holy Spirit to move among us. And there had been a tremendous outpouring of the Holy Spirit there in the last few months. And the power of the Holy Spirit was being manifested, was being evidenced, right, in the singing and the speaking and singing in tongues, prophecy, words of wisdom and knowledge. And those who had been attending the pre-service prayer had been greatly encouraged. Now this morning, we moved to a larger room in L4, where more of our members can come and join with a greater sense of unity, love, and purpose. I remember in one of our leaders' meeting, one sister said, you know, in Acts 2, they had the upper room. In FGA, we have the basement room. Right? But today, brothers and sisters, praise the Lord, we also have an upper room. Amen? Yeah? So, brothers and sisters, if you want to feel revival, you know, you don't need to go and see, you know, don't go and see Ashbury. Okay, just come to L4. Okay, come to level 4, Wisma FGA, right? You know, revival is not evidenced by large crowds of people. There can be large crowds of people, but if the Holy Spirit is not moving among them, there's no revival. Revival is evidenced by the move of the Holy Spirit among His people. And the Holy Spirit is moving among His people in FGA. Amen? Praise the Lord. Okay, so each and every one of us as believers, as Christians, has or will have the Holy Spirit in us. And each of us will be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that's a promise of our Lord Jesus Christ to us. So the question is this morning, what then must we do and how can we do it? Okay, so that brings us to Acts chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. This passage of Scripture is an account of the first miraculous sign and wonder performed by the apostles after they were filled by the Holy Spirit. It is the first mention of the empowering work of the Holy Spirit through the apostles. There have been many teachings and sermons on Acts chapter 3 before, but as I contemplated this passage, I found myself consumed more by the practical applications, okay, of this passage rather than the technical or theological study of it. And so for this, I'm going to use the three key postures in Holy Spirit-empowered discipleship that was shared by Elder Ho. I think as we begin to grow in the Spirit, it is good to speak the same language. It is good to be of one mind, united in thought and purpose. And that's what the Bible tells us to do in 1 Corinthians 1:10, right? So the three key postures the elder Ho spoke to us about is engage, encounter, and express. And as we go through Acts chapter 3, we're going to look at this from the point of view of the two key actors in the passage. Now, the first actor is Peter and John. Peter and John were in the upper room during Pentecost, and they were among those who were filled with the Holy Spirit that day. And in Acts chapter 3, verse 1, it reads, Peter and John went to the temple one afternoon to take part in the 3 o'clock prayer service. It was one afternoon. It was not on a particular event. It was not even on a Sunday service. It was one ordinary afternoon that Peter and John went to the temple. In fact, the Bible tells us that Peter and John went to the temple every day. In Acts chapter 2, verse 46, it says they worshiped together at the temple each day. So Peter and John engaged with God daily in their spiritual lives. This is key to a Holy Spirit-empowered discipleship, to engage with God daily and persistently. But what does it mean to engage with God in a Spirit-filled life? Let me just read from Galatians chapter 5, verse 25. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me. Galatians chapter 5, verse 25, it reads, Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Last week, Dr. Paul spoke in length to us about living by the Spirit. He said that we need to listen, we need to obey, and we need to follow the lead of the Holy Spirit. Following the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. We need to engage with the Holy Spirit daily. Amen? Now, in our home fellowship ministry, as we continue in our journey this year in Holy Spirit-empowered discipleship, we wanted to engage with God intentionally. We wanted to engage with God persistently. We wanted to engage with God on a daily basis. Not just on the Fridays when we met, not even on the Wednesdays, you know, of our prayer service, or even the Sunday service. We wanted to engage with God daily in our discipleship journey. Excuse me. And the Holy Spirit led us to a place where we needed to change our home fellowship culture. And so we have adopted a new approach. We have adopted a new home fellowship DNA with the acronym TEAMS. And it stands for, T stands for truth, the Word of God. E is equipping one another to build up the church. A is accountability to God and to each other. M is being missional, okay, do what Jesus did. And S is supplication, prayer, praying daily. And these five key ingredients that we have adopted will be inculcated into our home fellowship culture as our daily habits. It will become our way of life, our new way of life, you know, where we begin to engage with God daily. And one of the things that we wanted to do, and we are going to do, is that we want to do a daily Bible reading plan together. Okay, we want to do it together in unity. We want to do this with one mind, one spirit, one body, with the purpose of equipping God's people to do His work and to build up the church. Amen. And today, just a bit of promo here. And today, if you are not part of our home fellowship, okay, I would encourage you to join our home fellowship. Join us as we begin to engage with God together every day. Amen? All right, praise the Lord. Okay, let's move on. The second actor. Okay, now let's look at the second actor. The second actor is the lame man. This lame man, he was crippled from birth. Bible said he was more than 40 years old, and he sat outside the temple every day begging for money. Now, we venture to say that, this lame man, he was not only physically lame, but he was spiritually dead. Okay, here was a man who was sat outside the temple every day for years. Okay, and he was sat outside the temple, and he must have known who Jesus was. He must have seen Jesus coming in and going out of the temple, because he sat there for years, right? And I would say that he knew Jesus, but he knew Jesus only in his head knowledge. He didn't know Jesus in his heart. Okay? So he is what we call a lost soul. Now, as we spoke earlier, the Holy Spirit empowers us to be witnesses for Christ. The Holy Spirit empowers us as missional disciples to engage with the lost. So Peter and John engaged with the lame man so that the lame man could engage with Jesus. You get it? They turned his attention away from his distractions of life, you know. Right? In Acts chapter 3, verse 4, Peter and John looked at him intently, and Peter said, "Look at us." And the lame man looked at them eagerly, expecting some money. Here, Peter and John, filled with the Holy Spirit, engaged with the lame man. All right? And they engaged with the lame man so that the lame man could engage with Jesus. Okay. The verse says that, he was expecting some money. He was expecting something. Right? And that expectancy opened his heart to engage with Jesus. And that's the empowering work of the Holy Spirit. Now, remember, there was this time, when we had our personal evangelism workshop in Peace Haven. Right? This was many years ago, before the pandemic. And for the on-the-job training, okay, the OJT, we were sent two by two to Genting Highlands to share the gospel with total strangers. Okay, it was a terrifying notion. We were so terrified by the thought of going to share the gospel with total strangers. Okay, but before we went, we prayed. Okay, and our teams, empowered by the Holy Spirit, okay, we went. We went and we engaged with strangers as they were coming out of the casino. You know? As they were coming out of the casino, okay, we engaged with them. Right? Yeah, some of them came up, no more silver and gold. They came up and we engaged with them. Okay. And we shared the gospel with them in boldness and in faith. Okay. And I remember that day, two souls were saved. Praise the Lord. Okay. And we always say that it is not us who converted them. It is the Holy Spirit that had opened up their hearts so that they could engage with Jesus. Hallelujah. All right. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay. And next in chapter, in Acts chapter 3, verse 6a, Peter said, I don't have any silver and gold for you, but I'll give you what I have. Okay. So what did Peter have? What did Peter have? Peter had Jesus. Okay. The Bible says that when we give our lives to Jesus, it is not we who live, but it is Christ who lives in us. So when Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but what I do have, I give to you, Peter was saying that he had Jesus. He had something that was more valuable than silver and gold. Okay? And what he had was Jesus. And so Peter encountered Jesus because Peter engaged with Jesus daily in his spiritual life. Amen. I want to share with you that today I am speaking to you today is not because I am qualified to do so. It is not because of my ability. Okay, I'm not theologically trained. Okay, I am speaking to you today because of the empowering of the Holy Spirit. As I was preparing for this message, I was very stressed. Okay, I was very stressed. I even told my brothers, the pastors, I am so stressed. Okay, because I'm not theologically trained, you know. And you know what happened? As I sat down there every week and I was listening to the elders and the other speakers speak, I was like, "Ayo, he just used the point that I wanted to speak on." You know, I now don't know what else to talk about already, right? And but later, as I was putting together my notes for the sermon, and I was thinking, you know, maybe, you know, this is a little too simple, you know. Not theological enough, very plain. You know, we say no firepower like Julius Subi, right? And so on 22nd of February, and I remember this date because it was the date that I did my 8 hours with Jesus, okay? And so as I worshipped and I prayed, I asked the Lord, what Bible passage would you like me to read today? And then suddenly it popped into my mind, read 1 Corinthians. And I was thinking to myself, I read 1 Corinthians already. In fact, we were doing 1 Corinthians for our home fellowship Bible study. So I asked the Lord again, you know, what Bible verse or what Bible part of the Bible would you like me to read? And it came again, read 1 Corinthians. And so I obeyed and, you know, I read 1 Corinthians. Isn't it amazing how God speaks to us in a passage that we have read many times before, okay? And passages that we have read many times suddenly become rhema because of the situation we are in, okay? And for me, it was 1 Corinthians 2, verse 4, and the Apostle Paul said, and my message and my preaching was very plain. Rather than using clever and persuasive speeches, I relied only on the Holy Spirit. And that was God speaking to me. My rhema, okay, may not mean anything to you, but that was God speaking to me. Rely on the Holy Spirit. And rely on the Holy Spirit in my current situation. And my current situation, I was stressed about preaching, right? So that was God speaking to me. And God revealed many other truths in 1 Corinthians, okay, that day, some of which you will notice I use a lot of reference to 1 Corinthians this morning, okay? Right? So I encountered Jesus. I encountered Jesus because I engaged with Jesus in my 8 hours with Jesus. Amen? Hallelujah. Okay? Now next, just want to move on. In Acts chapter 3, verse 6, Bible reads, "In the name of Jesus, the Nazarene, get up and walk." Okay, Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, used the name of Jesus to indicate to the lame man that what Peter was about to give him was not from himself, okay, but it was from Jesus. Okay, he indicated to the lame man that he was about to encounter Jesus, right? And this could only happen, okay, by the power of the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, it says, "No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit." Can I hear an amen? Amen. Okay. All right. Then we come to Acts chapter 3, verse 7. Then Peter took the lame man by the hand and helped him up. And as he did, the man's feet and ankles were instantly healed and strengthened. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, expressed his faith in Jesus by taking the lame man by the hand and helping him up. Okay, Peter did more than just talk. Peter put faith into action. And verse 38, okay, he jumped up, stood on his feet, and began to walk. Then walking, leaping, praising God, he went into the temple with them. Okay, so likewise, the lame man also expressed his faith in Jesus by standing up and walking. Okay, now remember, this is a lame man from birth. Okay, he cannot walk. He cannot stand, and I'm sure he didn't even know how to, okay? But as Peter helped him up, the lame man put faith into action, okay? Right? And that's what we read in Acts chapter 3, verse 16, okay? It wasn't Peter who healed him, it was faith. Faith in the name of Jesus. And Acts chapter 3, 16 says, "Through faith in the name of Jesus, this man was healed. You know how crippled he was before? Faith in Jesus' name healed him before your eyes." Okay. Now this morning, how many of you here know Jesus is a God that heals? Amen. I see so many hands. You know, let me just quickly share with you, a quick testimony. In October 2019, okay, I had this excruciating pain in my upper back and shoulder. I was diagnosed with cervical spondylosis, okay? And it caused a pinched nerve, resulting in that pain, in that unbearable pain. I had treatment for many weeks, but there was still that 20 to 30% of niggling pain that was left in my neck. And the prognosis is that, you know, it would be with me, always, lah. It will come on and off, okay, right? And in December 2019, as I was attended the personal evangelism trainer workshop, okay, and I remember that was the first time I was meeting with my brothers for quite a while, because before that I had that neck pain, right? So as I met with them, I was sharing with them, and I remember Dr. Ong praying for me, okay. And as he was praying, Elder Dorai walked in. And Elder Dorai said, said something like, you know, "Stop worrying about the pain. Okay, Jesus has already healed you." And then he held me by the back of my neck and he said, "In the name of Jesus, be healed." And then he said, "Okay, sit down and now let's start the class." Okay. Now, I can't remember if I had that pain during the class. I actually cannot remember. But I remember that night when I went home, there was no more pain. Okay, right? And I have not had pain ever since. Praise the Lord. Yeah. Another short testimony: in August 2020, my mom had a stroke. Okay, she couldn't control her arm, her left arm, her left leg. You know, she couldn't walk on her own. And we prayed for her. No, actually, she prayed for herself. We just sat and prayed with her. Yeah. And we prayed with her over the long Merdeka holiday. Okay. And on the fourth day, God healed her. And God raised her and restored her completely. You know, you look at her and you wouldn't know that she had a stroke. Praise the Lord. Amen. So God is a God that heals. But how do we express that faith? Okay. How do we express that faith? I think it's pray and keep on praying. Right? In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, it says, the same Spirit gives great faith to another, and to someone else, the Spirit gives the gift of healing. God heals, and He gives us the faith to be healed. Okay? And God does this through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. All right. So the layman was healed by the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, I believe that God could have healed that layman at any time. I mean, he was sitting at the gate of the temple, right? Jesus passed him on the way in and on the way out, you know. God could have healed him any time. God could have healed him, he could have got up and he could have walked away and no one would have known, okay, right? Because nothing is impossible with God, yeah, right? God could have healed him at any time, but God had a different plan for the man. God healed the man by the empowering work of the Holy Spirit in Peter and John. But even greater than that healing was the man's newfound saving faith in Jesus Christ and the resulting transformation in the man's life. Okay, the Bible said that after he was healed, okay, right, he then walking, leaping, and praising God, he went into the temple with them. Okay, so many, many people saw the layman get healed. And all this happened because they engaged with Jesus, they encountered Jesus, and they express their faith in the name of Jesus. Amen? Can I just invite the worship team to come up as I close? Now, this morning, I want to tell you about a third actor in the book, in Acts 3. There is a third actor, and this third actor is not mentioned anywhere in Acts 3, but he is there. This third actor is the Holy Spirit. You know, not one verse in Acts chapter 3, 1 to 10 actually mentioned the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit was there. The Holy Spirit was there when Peter and John and the lame man engaged Jesus. The Holy Spirit was there when they encountered Jesus. The Holy Spirit was there when the lame man was healed. The Holy Spirit was there when they expressed their faith in the name of Jesus. And brothers and sisters, this morning, the Holy Spirit is here. And how do we know that the Holy Spirit is here? We know the Holy Spirit is here because the Holy Spirit is in us. The Bible tells us so. And this morning, brothers and sisters, the Holy Spirit wants to engage, encounter, and express Himself in us. So even as Pastor Wei-Ai closes us in worship, let us begin to respond this morning to the Holy Spirit. Let us make room in our hearts this morning for the Holy Spirit to engage, encounter, and express Himself in us. Let's put aside all distractions and come to Him this morning. Hallelujah. Let us make space for the Holy Spirit this morning here in this sanctuary to move among us. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, if this morning you have not received Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, and you say this morning, I would like to encounter Jesus, I would like to invite you to come. Come up here and we would like to pray with you. And if this morning you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, you want to have that encounter with the Holy Spirit this morning, you want to say, I want that power of the Holy Spirit, I want the Holy Spirit to empower me this morning, you come as well. You come as well. We want to pray with you. Hallelujah. And this morning, if you need healing, if you are sick, the Holy Spirit is here. The Holy Spirit has empowered us to receive healing in faith. The Holy Spirit has empowered us with the gift of healing this morning. And so our elders, our pastors, and our leaders are up here. And we want to pray with you. So come, come and we pray. Even as Pastor Wei Ai leads us in worship. Can we all rise? Can we all rise to our feet? Even as we sing this song, and even as we sing, we want you to come.
All it takes is one moment, and just one touch from you. Put aside all distractions, I came for you, I came for you. I need you more than. Nothing else satisfies. All my life I surrender. I live for you.
While waiting for
you, I live for you.
More to come up.
I came for you.
Once again, those in the balcony, in the extension room,
Holy
even in the praise room,
you are
come.
Welcome.
We'll pray for
come
you as well.
And move upon this place. We desire an encounter once again. And Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit.
Rest of us, let's continue to worship.
Jesus, take me deeper. I came for you. I came for you.
while the rest receive ministry at the altar. Let's look to God before we step out from this place of worship. Holy Spirit, we need you every day. Even as we see darkness coming upon this nation, upon this planet Earth, we need constantly to be filled with your Spirit, O Lord, that we will be empowered to live a life that will bring glory to your name, that will empower us not just to live, but to not just to survive as well, but to live victorious life. Because you who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. So Lord, as we draw strength from you every day, help us, Lord, not just to engage, not just to encounter, not just to express, but allowing you to empower us each step of the way. Challenges that we may face, unknown arrows that the evil one may send out to us, we will continue to look to you, Lord Jesus, who is the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. So as we step up from this place of worship, we will constantly present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to you, so that the Holy Spirit, you will find it a vessel fit for the Master's use. That we will not just receive blessing from you, but we will be a blessing to those around us, especially to those who are going through challenges themselves and those who are weakened by what the evil one has done in their life. So we thank you. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love from our Heavenly Father, and the ever-abiding presence of the Holy Spirit be upon each and every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Have a